Yeah, please, if you can keep your cameras on, will be best. Yeah, hello there. Hi, everyone. So today we have to continue from where we had left, right? The last time, what we had done was, I had given you the introduction part. We had also discussed the spinal cord, right? The spinal cord in detail we had discussed. We had discussed the TS of the spinal cord. Then we had went ahead, we had gone ahead to the, I guess we had also done about the reflex section, if I'm not wrong. I just started the reflex section, am I right? Yeah? Yes, guys, you're a total on mute today. Am I audible to all? Okay, fine. So we'll go further to the reflex section. We had done the introduction of the reflex action, right? That it is quick, automatic, involuntary, and often unconscious. You know, action brought about by the, when the receptors are stimulated, you know, by the external or the internal stimuli. When they're stimulated, you know, the reflexes do occur. So we had done a little bit of that also. So we have to now go ahead with the types of the reflex action. The reflex actions are of various types. So I'll just share the types of reflex action with you all. And there were some notes that you all wanted. So these are some of the notes I will share also. Yeah, so these are the notes for the spinal cord you are seeing. Yes, guys. These are the notes. You can see this is the spinal cord thing. So we have discussed everything, right? So that's how the from the medulla the spinal cord arises. The spinal nerve that you all can see, right? So this is about the spinal cord or the TS of the spinal cord. See, nice diagram to show you about the ventral dorsal roots. Okay, this is the spinal cord thing, the peripheral nervous system, right? We have talked about the cranial nerves and the spinal nerves. That also you completed yesterday, right? The entire table of the cranial nerves that I've given to you. So all these, the cranial nerves go into different parts. Then the spinal nerves, right? So we have the spinal nerves here. Formation of a spinal nerve, right? Cranial spinal nerve distinguished. All that we have completed. Yeah. Sure, I'll share. So we have done with the CNS, we've done with the PNS. We have to do the reflex actions. So I'll show you some more notes for reflex actions also now. Yeah, guys. So see, the reflexes, you know, like the types of reflexes that we are doing is of two types, no? That is the focus on the learning part, okay, guys? I'll share from here first. So the reflexes, you know, there are two types, the cranial reflexes and the spinal reflexes. The cranial reflexes are the ones which are, you know, carried out by the brain, and the spinal reflexes are carried out by spinal cord. I told you the cranial reflexes are, you know, slow acting. The cranial reflexes are the ones which act very slow, like watering of mouth, you know, on the sight or smell of some good food. So here the effector is a salivary gland, right? The effector is a salivary gland and watering of the mouth. So it's a cranial reflex. Because we smell, we see something, we think about something. So that is a cranial reflex. Spinal reflexes are both which are carried out by the spinal cord, and you know they are urgent, they are quick acting. Withdrawal of leg while, you know, stepping on something hot. I just told you same example yesterday. Unconditioned and conditioned is what I explained yesterday also, right? Unconditioned and conditioned. Now, to give an example of conditional reflex, there was an experiment called as the Pavlov experiment. You know, Pavlov experiment, it's there in psychology also. Psychology too has the, you know, this experiment called as the Pavlov's one, given by Ivan Pavlov. So anyone knows what is the Pavlov experiment? The Pavlov experiment, guys, is very simple. Ivan Pavlov, you know, what he did was, he just had a dog show. He used to ring a bell. It was to demonstrate conditional reflex. He used to ring a bell and, you know, he used to get the dog food, right? So the dog did not care about the bell initially. But when the bell was rung every time, you know, when he used to ring a bell every time before giving the dog food, what registered in the dog's mind is that whenever I ring the bell, you know, my master will give me food. So dogs are very smart. So what registered in their mind was that the bell to be the food. Right? The bell, when the bell will ring, the food you will get. When the bell will ring, the food you will get. That got registered after a few months, right? A few days. Then what happened one fine day, like, you know, the master just rang the bell but did not get any food. But still, what did the dog anticipate? The dog anticipated that, you know, I'm going to get food because the bell is rung. And, you know, so the dog had a lot of saliva, you know, in his mouth, and, you know, he was very much excited, wagging his tail and all. Right? So this, what does this tell us? This tells us that, you know, this is an example of the conditional reflex. This is an example of what? This is an example for the conditioned reflex action. If something is like, you know, it's like a condition. The bell became the condition for obtaining food. What became? Yes, Arya. The bell became the condition for obtaining the food. That became like a condition, right? So that is for the conditional reflex. Fine. Here to all. Same way, like, you know, so these are very, very simple ones. Then, what next, you know, that you have to understand is the types of reflexes based on. So here are the types of reflexes based on how many synapses are involved. What is the meaning of the word monosynaptic reflex? Monosynaptic reflex is like a small reflex where only one sensory and one motor is there, so one association is there. Example, a knee jerk reflex. Is a simple reflex. They are only monosynaptic, but 99% reflexes are polysynaptic. They are complex reflexes involving many, you know, so many nerves, you know, sensory as well as motor, cycling, swimming. They all are polysynaptic, right? So reflexes are based, you know, on three types, on basis of their origin, that is cranial or spinal. Then secondly, on the basis of their, whether the previous experience is required or not. So on that basis, the conditional and the unconditional. And then the simple or complex, right? You know, that is how many synapses are there? Are they simple or are they complex? Then you have to go ahead to the PNS and to the ANS, right? So we have to understand in detail about the PNS, that is the peripheral nervous system, and the ANS, that is the autonomic nervous system. So for this also, let me show you some notes. PNS we have already done, the peripheral, you know, the nervous system. Mainly what we have to understand about is the ANS, right? So guys, the ANS is the autonomic nervous system. Basically, you know, we divide the PNS only. The PNS is only divided into two parts, that is somatic nervous system and the autonomic nervous system. The somatic nervous system, you know, relays the messages or impulses from the brain to the voluntary muscles, that is the skeletal. So the somatic nervous system or the SNS or the somatic nervous system relays the impulses from between the brain and the skeletal muscles or the voluntary muscles of the body. That is for the somatic nervous system. And now the autonomic nervous system, you know, sends the impulses from the CNS to the involuntary organs. Right? They send the impulses from the CNS to the involuntary organs and the smooth muscles of the body. So CNS, you know, from the brain to the involuntary organs, right? And the smooth muscles. So that is very important. Now, what is there in the CNS, PNS and ENS? You know, there are two types. The ANS is divided into two types. That is the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system. So there are two types of the nervous system there. One is the sympathetic and one is the parasympathetic. Yeah. So here you can see the ANS. That's a nice diagram to show that for the ANS, it transmits the impulses from the CNS to the organs. So it is sending the impulses from where to where? From the CNS to the organs. So it communicates with organs and glands. It is for the involuntary responses. There are cranials and spinal nerves. So there are like two, neurons here, right? So there is one, see, this is the autonomic ganglia. Here is the CNS and here is the organ, like the involuntary organ. So guys, pay attention. Here is the CNS, the central nervous system, and here is the involuntary organ. So there are, this is the ganglia. You all know what is a ganglia, right? So there is a preganglionic neuron and there is a postganglionic neuron. There is a preganglionic neuron here and there is a postganglionic neuron, right? Postganglionic means what? After the ganglia, pre is before the ganglia. Now, what we have to understand is that the ANS is divided into two parts, sympathetic and parasympathetic. What's the role of sympathetic and what's the role of parasympathetic? Sympathetic is to arouse the body, mobilize the body, like, you know, for action. It's like for excitement. And parasympathetic is like a calming one. It calms, it relaxes. So that is the, you know, function for the parasympathetic. Sympathetic is for arousing and parasympathetic is for calming or, you know, relaxing one. So that way, you know, there are two, sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system. The sympathetic nervous system has got which type of outflow? Thoracolumbar outflow. What do you mean by they have got thoracolumbar outflow? These nerves, you know, they start from thoracic and the lumbar region. The sympathetic nerves, you can see they're starting from the thoracic and the lumbar region. So from the thoracolumbar outflow, right? That is for the sympathetic. And how many sympathetic ganglia are there? There are 22 pairs of sympathetic ganglia. There are how many pairs of sympathetic ganglia? 22 pairs of sympathetic ganglia. And there are, you know, they are arranged on two sympathetic cords. Like, you know, on either side of the backbone, there are sympathetic cords. So 22 pairs. So 22 ganglia here also and 22 ganglia here also. Right? So there are this one, you can see this is a sympathetic cord. So like one cord is here, the other cord is here. So there will be 22 here and 22 there. Right? 22 sympathetic ganglia. And parasympathetic is for craniosacral. That means the nerves arise from either the cranium or the sacrum. So they have got craniosacral outflow and they are, the ganglia are close or within the walls of the effector organ. The parasympathetic ganglia are within the, you know, effector organs. That is mostly the involuntary, you know, the organs. So that is about the sympathetic and parasympathetic. Now, what you see here is that in the, there is a difference between sympathetic and the parasympathetic. The sympathetic, the preganglionic nerve fibers are short and postganglionic are longer. So here what you can see is that in the relative length, right, the preganglionic are short right? Because the synthetic, why they have short? Because they have got the thoracolumbar, no? So they have to only travel from brain to the thoracic region, right? Thoraco and lumbar. So CNS gives the impulses, right? The short, because the preganglionic, you know, this ganglia is closed. So the preganglionic neurons are typically shorter in length, but as compared to the postganglionic neurons, you can see they are typically longer in length because you have to reach various targets. What they have to do is that they have to reach their different targets. Okay, so these are the pre and the post ganglionic neurons, and for opposite, you know, for the parasympathetic, the preganglionic are short and the post ganglionic, the preganglionic are long basically, and the post ganglionic are short. Here you can see the preganglionic because they are craniosacral, so from they have to arise from cranium and the sacral region, that is two opposite regions. So that's why the preganglionic neurons are long and the post ganglionic are short. Why the post ganglionic are short, guys? Because these parasympathetic ganglia are inside the organs or close to the organs. Are you getting my point? The ganglia are already in the organs. The parasympathetic ganglia are already present in the organs. So now from here to the organ, the distance is very short. But these ganglia, the sympathetic ganglia, they are on either sides of the backbone, no? So from there, they have to travel to different targets. That's the reason they are long. Are you getting the logic? And here, you know, the postganglionic fibers, here, what do they secrete? Which neurotransmitters the postganglionic secrete? Adrenaline and noradrenaline. And you all are aware that both adrenaline as well as noradrenaline, you know, they are for excitement. Guys, I want somebody to tell me the other name for adrenaline and noradrenaline. Anyone can tell me? No one? Yes, guys. Guys, I thought it will be more interactive today.
Sir?
Yes.
It's epinephrine or norepinephrine?
Yeah. Very good. Actually, you're answering in the chat. Oh. Are I don't see chat. Very good, very good. All of you are sending the chat. Yeah. Sneha is right. The 3F, fear, fright, fight. Arya, am I audible now? Am I audible to you now? Epinephrine and norepinephrine. Very good. Samiksha, Sneha, Vibha, Arya. Okay, Aryan. Fine. Right, cool. So actually you are communicate on chat. Oh. There's some kind of disturbance, Arya. Then what you do now, because others are able to hear me, what you can best do is just try to rejoin. Sometimes by that, you know, the problem could get solved. Anyway, so these fibers, they are called as what? Adrenergic. What are these fibers called as? Adrenergic. Because they're secreting adrenaline. Now the parasympathetic on the other hand, they are for what, you know, they are the postganglionic, right? So they secrete acetylcholine. So they are called cholinergic. Acetylcholine relaxes and adrenaline, you know, excites them. So they are cholinergic, okay? Sympathetic nervous system is for what, you know, response to the emergencies. They have excitatory, like running, you know, except, yeah, very, very important, the digestive and excretory. Sympathetic nervous system excites all the systems like respiratory, circulatory, but not digestive, right? And excretory, because when you are in tension, when you are in stress, you are not going to think about, you know, you are not going to go for, you know, ejection or defecation, right? You don't, we will not give priority for digestion and excretion when we are in stress, right? So that is the reason they both are sympathetic, excite all the systems except these two systems. Remember that. And parasympathetic is also known as the housekeeping system. It is really sleeping around. It is antagonistic to the sympathetic. It brings everything back to normal. In fact, it does the opposite work. It excites or it activates the digestive and the excretory system. Okay. Now there are lots of other ways also, like some more notes I'll show you. Okay. So many notes I have to really juggle them. Yeah. So then, you know, what next is this, the opposite action, you know, the contraindicating action for both the systems. Let us see that. How they both are exactly, you know, antagonistic to each other. 51 years, they're given nicely here. Yeah. So see this, what they have shown is that all of you will pay attention. These points are exactly opposite, but very important. What happens to the sympathetic? Like when you are angry and all, what happens to your pupils dilate? Like we dilate the pupils, no? So gusse se dekhte hai to pupils dilate. You know, at death the pupils remain permanently dilated. At death the pupils are permanently dilated. This is one of the tests for death, pupillary reflexes. When you put on a torch or some extreme light, when the pupils are permanently dilated, that is one sign of death. So when you are in anger, the pupils are temporarily dilated. Okay, and here parasympathetic they will constrict like normally, like right now. Right, so sympathetic, you know, it will cause activation of tears. Lacrimal glands will be activated, you know, for tears. And here, you know, they will inhibit tears and all, you know, because it's like normal life. Okay, when you are extremely happy, that also is sympathetic. Huh? Extreme sadness or extreme happiness, both comes in sympathetic. You know, guys, people have got heart attacks. Can you imagine that? I had attended a marriage where it can happen. So extreme happiness is also bad. Okay, so the sympathetic, you know, stimulates the secretion of tears. It inhibits flow of saliva because when you are in stress, you know, your mouth dries, right? When you are in stress, your mouth will become dry. Mouth sook jata hai na, you feel thirsty and all. And heartbeat will be obviously accelerated, right? Here it will slow down the heartbeat and the saliva will flow here because, you know, you are relaxed, you are like enjoying a dinner at your favorite restaurant. Okay. Here now, why the bronchi will dilate here? The bronchi will dilate, but the blood vessels will constrict. Why the bronchi will dilate? For obtaining more oxygen. Because you're in stress, your body needs more O2, more glucose. So bronchi will dilate and the blood vessels will constrict so that, you know, there is more. Why the blood vessel will constrict? Because it increases the blood pressure. The blood pressure will increase, right? So it has to supply glucose to the muscles. Here the opposite, the bronchi will constrict and, you know, it will also dilate the blood vessels. The blood vessels will get dilated. Blood pressure will be lower. Here, you know, they will inhibit peristalsis. I told you, know, digestion will not be given a priority. Here the peristalsis is going to be reduced, right? The gut peristalsis and secretion. Here it will be activated, stimulate peristalsis and secretion. Here what is going to happen, you know, adrenaline, noradrenaline will be made and there will be conversion of glycogen, you know, glycogen will be converted to glucose. And here it will be reversed, like dilution will be carried out, you know, stimulates release of bile. Now here, Acha, this is a very interesting thing I want to share with you all. Let's see your logic, guys. Let's see. No cameras on? No cameras on today also. Anyway. Okay. Who all are there? There are quite less students compared. Yeah, same number. All girls, as I see, you know, medical may 90% girls in this batch. Yeah. So guys, what I'm asking you is that the when the bladder contracts, see, when we are going for excretion, or while we are doing micturition, the bladder constricts or it relaxes. While doing micturition, I'm saying the bladder will relax or it will contract. When we are doing micturition, our bladder is going to contract or relax. Basically, that's my question. No one, guys. When we are doing micturition, you know, yes, Ashita is right. The bladder is actually contracting, and when we are not doing micturition, the bladder muscles are relaxing. So that's a confusion that many have. They think that when the bladder is filled up, the bladder contracts. Like, you know, urinary bladder has capacity of what? Maximum 800 ml to 1000 ml, 1 liter max. So what happens is that when we are not going for urination, suppose our bladder is getting filled up, it has become full. At that time, the bladder muscles, that is the detrusor muscles, are they contracting or relaxing? Students say, sir, they are contracting. Why? Because they feel muscles are contracted. Actually, they are relaxing. So because they relax, they can increase their size. And while doing micturition, the bladder muscles squeeze, they contract. Right? You got the logic? Bladder muscles are detrusor muscles. So, you know, the opposite of what it is. So contract and relax, like, you know, the detrusor. So the sympathetic and the parasympathetic, what we shall do is, yes, very good answer. What the sympathetic will do is that, during sympathetic, what will happen is that these bladder muscles will inhibit contraction, right? They will, because we are in stress, right? So they will inhibit contraction, and they will relax. And here they will contract. Like, you know, when you are in normal situation, they shall contract. So basically, these are the points. Like, you know, the same thing, but these are the points to distinguish. You know, it is the same as that inhalation, exhalation thing. You know, when we inhale, the air pressure in the lungs increases or decreases. And 90% students say that when we inhale, the air pressure in the lungs increases. It's opposite. It actually decreases. When we inhale, the air pressure in the lungs decreases. And when we exhale, the air pressure in the lungs actually increases. Right? That's how it is. Okay, guys, one more thing. Like, during stress, what happens, you know, whatever liver and muscles, the glycogen was stored, you know, in the liver and muscles, that is reconverted back to glucose. So what is that process called? That is called glycogenolysis means what? Conversion of glycogen back to glucose, right? So glycogen will be reconverted to glucose, right? And during normal situation, like, the glucose will be converted to glycogen and stored for future use. That is called glycogenesis. Glycogenesis is brought about by insulin, and glycogenolysis is brought about by glucagon, alpha cells. Remember? Okay. Yeah, then going ahead, you know, so we have already completed about this cholinergic and adrenergic. The distinguish was very easy. That way it was easy to understand. Okay, now this is again one of my important parts. Like, you know, for obviously I have told you the books and all yesterday for reference and all. I'll be sharing a lot of extra synopsis through there. Okay, whatever I'm doing, I'll be going ahead with lots of extra synopsis today only. So we'll go to the receptors and the effectors. Effectors are the muscles and glands. So nothing to do in that. Glands and muscles. Muscles we have learned in the 11th standard in detail. Right? Entire skeleton chapter, the muscles part, voluntary, involuntary, cardiac, and so on. Now, what are the receptors? Now, there are two types of receptors, guys. The exteroceptors and the interoceptors. Exteroceptors are the receptors, you know, which are external or they are placed externally. And the interoceptors are the ones which are internally placed. So extero receive the external stimuli, intero is for the stimuli that comes from within the body. So let's talk about the exteroceptors. That is a phonoreceptor. Phono means what? Phone, like you know, mobile. So where are they present? They're present in the internal ear or the inner ear. And there's a region called an organ of Corti. We'll be doing when we do the ear structure. Organ of Corti. So what's the function, guys? That is the sound reception, obviously for sound, hearing. Tactoreceptor. See, guys, all these things, even I could write one thing on the whiteboard, right? Even I can do the same thing. I can go on the whiteboard and start writing each and everything. But for me, you know, it's like, it's simply, you know, just a waste of time that I write on the whiteboard the same stuff, then you copy and then I explain, you know. So it's like everything is there, you know, in online lectures. That's the fun of it, right? That we could maximally utilize the time to show something extra, some important things. Right? During offline, we have no option but to write all these things again on the whiteboard. But now, I don't think it is needed. That's the only way I'm projecting it directly. Because I've got my notes also, I've got the text also. And remember, text is not any degrading part. That studying from text is like not downgrade. Come on. I mean, like, it's very important. In fact, I told you, the CBSE people, they study our textbook for NEET. Because they say that they like our book. You know, grass is greener on the other side. CBSE board students study government textbooks for me because they feel that your textbooks have given it more nicely, precisely, point-wise, and more information in most of the chapters. So the statoreceptors, right? The internal ear, right? Where are the stato? Stato means for balance. So they are also receptors in the inner ear, and they are in the semicircular canals. You know, there are semicircular canals like three of them parallelly placed, you know, at right angles to each other. I'll show it to you. And they are maintaining their equilibrium and balance. If the fluid in the semicircular canal na thoda imbalance ho jata hai, then the balance goes. And, you know, that is called vertigo. Has anyone of you all heard about vertigo? It's a very bad thing. I've seen vertigo patients in front of myself. Yes, Arya, very good. Malleus intestis, that is the bones of the inner ear, right? Bones of the ear, the middle part. Yeah. So vertigo means what, you know, entire pura room ghumta hai. It's not that, see, when we are only roaming, then obviously it will happen. But they get up and they look out and entire room is like swelling. That's called vertigo. They can't walk also. Right? So it's like really dangerous. So that is the vertigo. That happens because of death, you know, some fluid change in the perilymph and the endolymph. There are some ear fluid, the canal fluid, you know, it vibrates like. Because the same, the canal fluid, when the pressure changes, no, that is the time when you also fear earache, ear pain during flight. Have you all gone? Like, you know, when you go for flights, no, many people have problems during landing. When I used to travel, initially when I used to get, like many years back, during my first few flights, I got a lot of issues. When not during the, you know, takeoff, but when it stabilized and during the time of landing, slowly, when they decrease the altitude, that's the time your ear fluid, you know, there changes the equilibrium, the pressures for earache. So this phono we done, we did with the stato, right? The photo is obviously there, no need for that. We all like selfie photos, retina of the eye, receive stimuli for vision. Thermo is in skin, right? That is for heat and cold both. For heat, this is called caroreceptors. And for cold, it is called as what? Frigido receptor. So, right? For heat and cold, right? Caloreceptors and frigido receptor. It's not frigido, guys. It's frigido.
Oh, sir.
Yes.
So, I have a doubt, actually. So, sure. We know that the fluid in the ear is used for our balance, right? And but we spin around, or people suffering from vertigo, we actually see the room is rotating or spinning. So how is our balance associated with our eyes?
No. Could you repeat that? I got that fluid capacity. When we are rotating ourselves, or when we are playing any game of turning round and round, then what happens is that even we stop, right? We stop rotating the fluid in the ear canal. It spins for some time. That's the reason we get this that's the reason we stop spinning, but the fluid keeps spinning for some time. That's the reason we get like.
Because of that, we see the room is also spinning. That is how it is associated with our eyes.
Our eyes, the spinning sensation. See, no. You are confusing. It's a complex mechanism, right? It is associated with your ear fluid, obviously, and it is associated with our eyes because we are seeing the room is spinning, right? So that our eyes are only seeing, right? But it's basically it's a kind of your inertia, right? Remember that inertia, like when brake is applied, you go forward and brake. So when we stop spinning. Right, but the ear fluid spins for some time. That is the reason, you know, these nerves are all interconnected, you know, because of, and we are seeing through the eyes only. So the
brain itself gets confused if we are spinning or not when we stop. When we stop actually spinning.
Not the brain is not confused. You can't say it is confused. It is just that when we have physically stopped spinning, but you know, the internal, the nerves, any fluids, you know, inside, they have not stopped spinning. They'll stop spinning after some time. It's like how you switch off the fan. You can switch off the fan button, but the fan is not going to stop as soon as you switch off the fan button. It's going to take some time, and after that, it is going to stop.
Okay, you know, got it. Thank you.
Simple as that, but it's all very complicated, though. You know, your question is very good. But when it comes to nerves and nervous stuff, it's pretty much complicated. It's neurology, you know, pura neurons per synapse. See, we got 30,000 million neurons just in the brain. So there's a lot of interconnections and complex mechanisms. And trust me, there is this vertigo and all, you know, even there are a lot of investigations. Neurologists ke paas jaate hai, bahut sare, so bhi kabhi kabhi pata nahi chalta hai what is the exact cause. They do a lot of tests. They do EMG, they do this, EEG, they do MRIs and all, you know, lots of investigations. And then they may be, you know, so vertigo, as you know, vertigo doesn't have a permanent cure. There are some tablets called Vertin and all with balance the fluid or the ear canal, but there is no permanent cure for vertigo. It can come anytime. It's like fix, like, you know, they can come anytime. There's no guarantee. So it's like very complex. Neurological disorders, as we, you know, today also there is no cure for neurological disorders like multiple sclerosis, schizophrenia, Alzheimer's, you know, right? There is no cure. Lots of things are like just like they're managing it little bit. Amnesia, you know, total amnesia, or lots of disorders are there like that. Good question. Then the chemo, right? The chemo receptors. So mechanos, they're in the skin, that is correct. Chemo are where are the chemo ones? Cascadia and olfactory. Chemo is chemical, taste is a chemical, and smell is chemical. So olfactory receptors are, you know, olfactory epithelium in the nose. I only told you, right? What is the olfactory epithelium also called as? The Schneiderian membrane, you know, I might have told you that. Olfactory epithelium is in the part of the epithelial tissue, right? Olfactory epithelium is called as the Schneiderian membrane. And the gustatory is the taste bud. You know, actually, taste buds are a part of papillae. You know the word papillae? The papillae, they decide the papillae contains the taste buds. And they're sensitive to different tastes like sweet, sour, salty. Like, you know, and there are like 10,000 different smells. You know, taste and smell is a very important sensation, guys. Right? Taste and smell are very, very important sensations. Yeah, it can be caused by nerve damage. Basically, it is basically due to accumulation of beta amyloid protein basis. Accumulation of a beta amyloid protein in the brain, you know, that is one of the reasons. Nerve damage, obviously, total or partial nerve damage. So then what I was saying was about this, I was talking about this part, no, that is the gustatory and olfactory. Remember on the tongue, you have different areas for taste, right? At the tip, you have the sweet, at the back, you have the bitter, and the sides, you have salty and sour. You know, so technically, you know, they are all interconnected. So it's not like if I take a Karela and if I keep it on my tip, it is sweet and salty and sour. It's not going to be like that, right? It's going to be the same sensation throughout, and because they all are interconnected. And there are different types of papillae also. You know, the papillae, you know what is spicy? Do you know spicy? Is it the taste? Is spicy? Is it spicy a taste?
No.
So what is it then? We all love spicy food, right? Most of us.
It's savory or umami.
It is umami, that is right. It's like an umami, but spicy is not a taste. It is the burning sensation of nerves. Spicy is burning sensation of nerves. The nerves get irritated. That's like the burning sensation. Due to irritation, there is burning. Right? So that is the spiciness. Yeah, capsaicins. There are some chemicals in the teas and all. Good. Very good. All right. So we go further. And there are different papillae. You might not be aware that is the circumvallate papillae, foliate papillae, you know, valvate papillae. Different papillae are there in the tongue also. Then we will go further to the next receptor. What are the interoceptors? Now, Zoom has this issue. Yeah. So, what happens is that this the interoceptors have got the enteroreceptors. Inside there are entero and proprioceptors. The enteroreceptors are for the internal organs, right? And they are sensitive to, like, you know, hunger, thirst, pain, you know, osmotic pressures. So any organ, internal organ pain, hunger, thirst, that is managed by the enteroceptors. Maybe stomach pain or any pain anywhere. Proprioceptors are in the joints, muscles and tendons. So they detect the changes in the movements of joints or tendons, muscle pain, tension, vibrations. And last is the baroreceptors. The baroreceptors are very important. They're also grouped as mechanical, but yeah, wow, thank you. So the baroreceptors, you know, where are they present? They are present in the walls of the atria, right? Or the vena cava, that is superior and inferior vena cava, and the aortic arch, right? The carotid arteries, carotid sinus. And they are detecting the changes in the blood pressure. So to restore the homeostasis through vasodilation and vasoconstriction. So they are very important. They balance the blood pressure changes. What are they doing? They're balancing the blood pressure changes in the walls, you know, carotid artery, internal carotid supply blood to brain. So because there should be homeostasis, blood pressure should be balanced. That work is done by the baroreceptors. If the baroreceptors get imbalanced, you know, any fault in these receptors, then the blood pressure will go like havoc. There will be total mess in the blood pressure, right? In the carotid, aorta, aortic arch, and various places. Now, then come see, before I go ahead to the eye and ear, I wouldn't go to the eye and ear right now. I'll go to the extra synopsis. Right? Yeah, since you're seeing, let me just cover this part. Interior, right? They create distress. Yeah, first is ID. Initially, we used to call it MR, mental retardation. But mental retardation, like we used to call somebody mad and insane. Do you know, guys, the terms like insane, it's a biological term. Do you know when we call somebody as imbecile or a moron, right? It's a term for low IQ. Low IQ people are imbeciles or morons or idiots, even idiot for that matter. Right? Even idiot for that matter. So intellectual disability is there. Autism spectrum disorder. Autism, you must have seen people with autism disorders. Bipolar disorders, like, you know, they are bipolar, like two personalities and all, like depression. Depression is so common nowadays. Anxiety, ADHD, yes. You know, nowadays, if teenagers have got ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, they like to attract people towards them, right? You know, they want attention seekers. They want to be in the limelight. So that we have seen a lot. somebody is doing this annotation. Can you please switch on the annotation so I come to know who's helping me out? So next time, you know, I will tell him only to do, and I will only take the trouble, you know. Yeah. So in the next part, what we have to understand. Parkinson's, you know, I've seen a lot of patients recently. I've referred them to neurologist obviously. Parkinson's is what? It is degeneration of the dopamine producing neurons. Dopamine, you know, is like a happy hormone, neurotransmitter. So there's degeneration of these neurons causing Parkinson's. Symptoms gradually develop over the years. There is tremor, stiffness, difficulty in walking, balance, coordination, and the Alzheimer's that we were talking about. The Alzheimer's, like, you know, slowly and steadily they cause memory loss. Like, you know, schizophrenia also, I've seen real patients with schizophrenia. They behave like two people, two personalities from time to time. Dementia is what? Memory loss. Is, you know, slow thinking, slow cognitive functions, reasoning, behavior, abilities. It occurs due to, yes, see, the loss of cholinergic fibers. Right? I told you, know, acetylcholine, cholinergic fibers are destroyed, other neurons are destroyed in the CNS. And accumulation of this amyloid protein, I told you, know, there is some beta amyloid protein. There is no cure for Alzheimer's, but treatment can slow down the progression and can improve the quality of life. So these are some things. I'm now sharing the part for I'm going to our big book. Yeah, sure, sure. Yeah. So see here, this yes, so we were on the sympathetic, right? So sympathetic, I told you that there is this thoracolumbar outflow, preganglionic are small, postganglionic are large, basically, you know, acetylcholine. The postganglionic secrete. See here now, preganglionic secrete acetylcholine, but the postganglionic secrete the sympathetin. Yeah, sympathetin is also norepinephrine, right? Something new. What did you realize? The preganglionic and the postganglionic. The preganglionic here also secretes acetylcholine. Huh? In the sympathetic, I'm saying, yes, in the sympathetic, the preganglionic secretes acetylcholine. The postganglionic is the one which secretes to the organs, right? They secrete sympathetin or the norepinephrine. And there is expenditure of energy and condition of pain, fear, anger. Parasympathetic is the cranial secret. And here the pre and post both secrete acetylcholine. Don't you feel, guys, this is a very tricky MCQ for me? Don't you feel so? I mean, come on, who's going to know this? They will know that, chalo, preganglionic, sympathetic, preganglionic, chota, postganglionic is long, but you know, when they ask you an MCQ like preganglionic secrete dash and postganglionic secrete dash. I mean, everywhere, they may give, if I am there, I will get an MCQ like this, you know, epinephrine and norepinephrine, or norepinephrine and epinephrine, or, you know, so it's going to be very confusing. Nobody will mark acetylcholine in sympathetic, right? But preganglionic here secrete acetylcholine, post secrete sympathetin, or the norepinephrine mainly. And here pre and post both secrete the acetylcholine only. Yeah. See, we have seen this Horner syndrome results from damage of, it results from the damage of sympathetic trunk of one side. So on one side, you know, Horner syndromic syndrome hai, jisme sympathetic, you know, trunk or ganglia are damaged on one side. So patient with Horner syndrome, you know, he lacks sweating on affected, you know, can you imagine on one side there is no sweating? There's like zero sweating on the affected side. There's no sweating on the affected side, and sunken eyes are there, constricted pupils are there. Oh my God, so many points to distinguish. I think some of them, yeah, can you see the point? So nice. So some of the points, you know, blood vessels, you know, in sympathetic, they are going to contract. In parasympathetic, they are going to relax. See here, acetylcholine as well as sympathetic, and here only acetylcholine. Blood pressure, blood vessels will contract because, you know, we want more, you know, this blood. So blood vessels to heart will dilate. Blood vessels to lungs and muscles, what will happen to them? They will dilate. You will be seeing all these things. Iris will constrict in sympathetic. Iris will dilate in parasympathetic. Salivary gland, digestive gut, everything will decrease. Ejaculation will increase. The sexual desire and ejaculation is increasing in sympathetic and will decrease in parasympathetic. Renin will obviously increase in sympathetic, right? Because of increased blood pressure. Oh, nice. Really nice. It was asked in Jitmar, I remember. Cutting of sympathetic or parasympathetic nerve to the heart will not stop the functioning of heart. Why it will not stop? Because heart will beat but without any nervous control. Why? Why heart will beat without any nervous control? Because guys, our heart is myogenic. I hope you are aware of it. Right? So your heart will beat but without any nervous control, even though sympathetic or parasympathetic nerves cut off. Autonomic nervous system, who's doing that? Autonomic nervous system functions rapidly after, autonomic will rapidly alter the visceral function. That is after 3 to 5 seconds. It is activated, you know, mainly by centers like, so anyway, that is not there for the MCQ. I hope you know the living substance, life substance is the protoplasm. This is all that you have done with all unknown law and all these things. Yeah, so there are types of neurotransmitters, like, you know, there are excitatory and there are inhibitory also. The ones which are excitatory are all these acetylcholine, norepinephrine, all these serotonin, 5-HT is also very important, 5-hydroxytryptamine, dopamine, histamine, glutamate, epinephrine, gastrin, glucagon, melatonin, ADH. You know what is melatonin? It's the sleep hormone. Don't forget, confuse with melanin, okay? Or melanocyte stimulating hormone, that is different. GABA is gamma aminobutyric acid, which is inhibitory, as well as glycine amino acid is inhibitory. So you know what is this all or none's law, like, you know, when they contract, they all contract together or they don't contract at all. The sense organs, right? Now here we will do something extra. Like, see, for specifically for touch, there is sigmoreceptor and tectoreceptor. Sigmo and tectoreceptor are specifically for touch. Sigmo and tecto, also they are there for touch. Yeah, so see, for olfactory, gustatory, you know, caloreceptors, frigido, see, I was studying frigido. Galvanoreceptors are sensitive to electric current. Galvanoreceptors are for electric current. Rheoreceptors are sensitive to water or air current. This is for the fish. Do you know fish have got certain line called as a lateral sense line? I hope some students will remember their 11th standard. Fish ke paas ek lateral, you know, sense line hai. And because of that, you know, lateral sense line, you know, they have the rheoreceptors in that. Georeceptors for gravity. Yeah, teroreceptors sensitive to distance. So we can perceive the distance, no? Kitne object long hai. That's because of teroreceptors. More, you know, best for the birds and all. Propryo I've done, intero we've done. Yeah, now few important receptors apart from that is the let's see which are the receptors and what are the functions. There are the Merkel corpuscles and Merkel discs. They are found in the epidermis. And there is this mesenchymal corpuscle for touch and pressure. They are in the feathers and in the hair. So in our hair, when we touch the hair, we can feel it, right? When we touch the hair, we can feel it. That's because of the mesenchymal corpuscle. Then pacinian, very important. Pacinian is for pressure. P for pacinian, P for pressure. Pacinian are in the deep layers of dermis. You know the dermis is the lower layer of skin. There, which are present in pacinian corpuscle. In the reptiles, I told you olfactory epithelium is Schneiderian membrane. There is an organ called Jacobson's organ. And they are the most common, you know, in the reptiles. They first appeared in the amphibians and then developed in snakes, lizards, Cynodon, that is, you know, a reptile. And it is basically, it is not found. Jacobson's organs are found in marsupial rodents, in human fetus. See, in man it is vestigial, but it is found in the fetus. In man it is vestigial, but they are found in the fetus. So guys, who will tell me, I'm sure you have done the chapter, no? Evolution is over, right, for y'all? Who will tell me that having the Jacobson's organs or the vomeronasal organs in the fetus is a proof of what? Having the Jacobson's organs or the vomeronasal organs is a proof of? Okay, Arya. It's a proof. You don't know this, guys. Come on, don't you know about biogenetic law? Are you aware of biogenetic law? Ontogeny, come on, you don't know this? Ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny. Why do we have this vomeronasal organ? You know, Jacobson's organs. Ontogeny recapitulates phylogeny. That is called biogenetic law. It was given by what? It is also called recapitulation theory given by Hackel. So, ye kya bolta hai? Like our life history, that is our ontogeny, will follow the ancestral life history, that is phylogeny. Right? So in the lower animals, you know, this Jacobson's organs were present. Right? So, in even the same way, in human fetus also, the Jacobson organ is present. That is an example of what? That is an example of the, you know, it's a proof of the biogenetic law. Did you understand? Like our heart, like today we have four-chambered heart, perfectly four-chambered heart. But when our human fetus was developing, it started with two-chambered and three-chambered, imperfect four-chambered and perfect four-chambered. So they also followed the same format, what happened in our ancestors. Right? So that is the biogenetic law. Himanshu, readiness means like to want to do. Readiness means to want to do some activity. Readiness means jo wish hoti hai. So then which are the other receptors? Then there is, we have the crosses and bulbs. Right? They are sensitive for temperature, pain, and frigido in nature means they are for cold. Crosses and bulbs is for cold. It's to sense cold and for, you know, pain also. Where are they found? They are found in lips, right? Or the fingers, tongue. Then organ of Ruffini. Ruffini is for temperature and for heat. Organs of Ruffini are for heat. Right? And there's a part called ampulla of Lorenzini. It is found in the snout. That is, you know, sharks are nose side. For helping in detection of temperature of water. Because guys, you know, why they need to know? Because they are cold-blooded, remember? Fish, amphibians, they are cold-blooded. So they need this for, you know, detection of their body temperature so that they can change their temperature as per the surroundings. Okay, so then we have to go further to the part for the eyes and the ears. So eye and ear are obviously they're very important and major sensory organs. And the first part that is the we'll first start with the ears. They're very interesting. There are a lot more from this book. I can show like a lot more synopsis. Like it's like lots of interesting things are there. Like, you know, this like specifically for the hormones, like I hope you're aware of pheromones and all. So okay, so we'll keep that for the later part. We'll focus on the things that are currently in progress. So the eye and ear structure. The eye and ear structure. Or would you like to solve MCQs? You would like to solve MCQs or you do the MCQs at the end? Yes, you would like to solve the MCQ for excretion, for this reflex action and PNS, CNS, PNS and ANS? Or would you like to go to the ear theory? All your choice, guys. I don't mind anything. But what I do is that generally when I do a subtopic, I call the instances of that. Because, you know, mixing everything would be sometimes confusing. Okay, so let's check out, let's solve some MCQs. I'll come to know like how well you're prepared, where well you're doing. So what you can do is that when I do the MCQs with you all, just send the answer in the chat. Right, direct message to me, send the answer in the chat to me directly. And put the question number also, so that I come to know like, which is that for what you are answering, okay? So, so great. Let's solve these MCQs from this book. Let me see how well you can solve. I've never seen. So we'll start with the spinal cord, right? Because we did the spinal cord part also. Yeah, so let's see if you can solve this one. Can you try 58 one, guys? MCQ number 50. Question number 50, please. Okay, no Arya, you're saying C. Ashita, right? This is the neat lecture. Some funny guys doing all these things, you know. Suits you. Never react to nonsense is what I follow. So the C, B, B, and so no, not an issue. Let me check. Because guys, see, knowing the theory is one thing and solving MCQ is the other thing. Be a master at, you know, MCQ solving when it comes to need. So see, B is the stimulus, right? A is the stimulus, then B has to be the receptor. There's no doubt about that. Then the sensory, right? Then the motor, the effector and the responses has to be B. Very good. Good answer. I think it was not that tough, no? It was quite easy. Right? So, yes, Devang, you're right. Ashita, Manshu, and Sonali. Okay, then next one. Try to solve this. On a similar line, you know, I'm giving you for the knee jerk reflex. Similar MCQ. Okay, I'll give you something more tough. Yeah, see, I just solved that. Did I not just solve this first one? See, the common AMU exam, DPMT, and Maharashtra CET also 2006. The pacemium corpuscle is present in skin for what? Very good answer. Pressure, that is correct. Very good, Arya also. That's for pressure. So then, could you solve for 12th one? Proprioceptors are those which give the sense of. What is the role of the proprioceptors? The answer is right, you know, changes in the internal movement of the body. Okay, try to answer the MCQ number 4, the NCRT MCQ number 4. The function of a visceral organ is controlled by. Functioning of a visceral organ is controlled by. Is it the sympathetic and somatic? Is it sympathetic and parasympathetic? Is it central and somatic? And is it none of the above? Very good. Arya, Ashita, and you're right. Devang and Himanshu. It will be D. Sympathetic and parasympathetic. Right? Very good. Mukta is right. Okay? It won't be, see, none of the above, not a chance. It won't be somatic, right? Because it's visceral organ. So only somatic. So option is gone. At the same time, it won't be C because it's not for somatic and central also. Yeah, could you try for MCQ number 3? MCQ number 3. Very less students are marking. Vibha, Mukhtar, all are giving different answers. See, what will happen here? How do parasympathetic? See, parasympathetic means what? They will relax. So, A cannot be the answer. A cannot be the answer. Heart rate is increased without affecting the cardiac output. But why do we require it, right? We don't require it. Reduce both heart rate and cardiac output. And heart rate decreases, but cardiac output increases. Why? The answer will be C. Why will they increase the cardiac output? It will be C. Very good. So, Viba, Sonali, Arya, you're right. Guys, do you know by any chance who's this guy? Who's doing this? See, this came in the MCQ. I explained to you the accumulation of protein. Remember, amyloid beta peptide. So now, can you answer what will be the answer for the fourth one? Very good, very good. The answer is Alzheimer's. Perfect. The answer is Alzheimer's. Yeah, so please try for the MCQ number 11. MCQ number 11. Yes, very good. Vagus nerve, guys. Vagus nerve, guys. It's a 10th cranial nerve. The answer is C. It is a 10th cranial nerve. The answer will be C. What is it? It's a 10th cranial nerve. What is vagus? The 10th cranial nerve. Yeah, great. Yes, so please solve for the MCQ number 12. Please try MCQ number 12. Very good. Good answer, everyone. Yeah. It's a part of autonomic. No, vagus nerve. Yeah, vagus nerve. Vagus nerve is a 10th cranial nerve. Cranial nerve, we didn't know that the 10th one was vagus. Remember the longest nerve? Right? It was the longest nerve, right? So that was the 10th one. It is the longest only. Okay, now we'll do some tough critical ones. Yes, could you solve this? I told you this 5 minutes back. Organs of Ruffini are receptors for what? It came in VHU. Very good. It is for heat. No. Heat is right. Arya is right. Shiba is right. It is for heat, guys. Proscenium is for pressure. Right? For pressure, it is proscenium. Yeah, so great. So let's continue ahead. Do you know the brain waves? There is something called as EEG. Electroencephalography, it is called. It is called as for the electroencephalography, that is for the brain signals. See this MCQ again. Which one of this is a 16th one, you try please. So 16 will be, yeah, very good also. Perfect. It will be unaffected, right? It will be unaffected. That is correct. Yeah. 17th one, please. The 17th one. I think, what is this? Himanshu, yes, Himanshu is saying A. Optic, very good. Eighth is auditory. So, optic ke baad, it will be auditory, will be the eighth one, right? So, third, eighth and nine. Ninth is again hypo, ninth is glossopharyngeal. Right, so it will be C, option C, that is right, it will be optic, facial, auditory, and glossopharyngeal. Option C. Okay, so chalo, good, good, you're solving well. Anosmia is loss of smell. It is a COVID ka symptom. Anosmia, like, you know, it is called loss of smell. It's a symptom of COVID, right? And see, this one I just discussed with you. Which of the following sense organs are unique in fish? So what will be the answer? It will be the lateral sense line, no? Lateral sense line, rheoreceptors. Right? They have got the rheoreceptors, the lateral sense line. Yeah, good. So you have solved the MCQs well. Going further, you know, to the ear part. If we go further to the ear part now, we have got the ear, because the reason being that, see, we can hear between 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz. What is the size, the hearing? 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz. Below 20 Hz is called as infrasonic sound or infrasound. Above 20,000 is called as ultrasonic or the ultrasound. Now, here is quite an interesting thing. You know, here has got the external ear. We used to generally say the pinna, you know, only as the external ear. It's not like that. The external ear has got different parts. Middle ear has got different parts. The inner ear has got different parts. So, what will remain unaffected in rabbit? Rabbit, the MCQ is basically nahi aata. Arya, just about the rabbit. What about rabbits, like you're asking? I could not understand. Parasympathetic question. Where is that? But which question? Do you know the question number? I explained, no, that see, sympathetic and parasympathetic, when it is cut, you know, it will not affect, because, you know, our heart is myogenic, so it will keep on beating. No, I just explained to you all, right? That if the sympathetic or parasympathetic nerve is cut, right, to the heart will not stop beating. It will still continue, no? Do you remember that in the synopsis side, this is with you? So rabbit is also mammal. And a rabbit is also mammal, right? Specifically, so the ear, yeah. Yes, right, Himanshu, right, Himanshu. Very good, Himanshu. Okay, so what I'm saying is that, you know, if you are just starting the introduction of the ear, so ear has got external, maybe like inner ear. And, you know, when we get ear infection, generally, you know, when we get throat infection, we get ear pain. So ear and throat are connected because there's a tube here called as the Eustachian tube. It starts from the middle ear and it goes to the pharynx. You all know pharynx is the place where the tonsils are there. You know, so that's why the cough cold relation with pharynx, you know, and the tube from the pharynx going to the ear. You know, that is the middle ear, that is the Eustachian tube. Okay? You want to open up your Eustachian tube? Can we exhale? We can exhale through the Eustachian tube. Do you know we can exhale through our Eustachian tube? What we simply need to do is we need to press the nose and blow air out through the ear. That could be done. This is how you clear your, you know, so that is the technique of I think I have identified who's the person doing Masti. It is Masti, I guess. Anna, am I right? So, anyway, so that is the ear. So, Eustachian tube connects both of them. Now, it fades the volume for some time. That is not because it put pressure on the Eustachian tube. There is an infection. Like, see, there are lots of things, guys, like that. You know, valve, Havergen system, pata hai, for bone mein Havergen system hai. There's one more place where you have the word Havergen. You know where? I don't know. I don't think you all know. Like Eustachian word is connected to valve also. The inferior vena cava. Inferior vena cava goes into the right atrium. There the valve is Eustachian valve, right? And here it is the Eustachian tube. Like infundibulum is there in the fallopian tube also. It's where it's connecting the hypothalamus and the pituitary. That is also connected by infundibulum. Similarly, Havergen system is there in the bones. Remember the bones, mammalian bones have got Havergen system. And there's one more valve called Havergen valve. You know where is the Havergen valve? The Havergen valve is in the opening of superior vena cava into the right atrium. By knowing that superior vena cava, when it opens into the right atrium, there is the Havergen valve. There are lots of things like that, guys. Like you say, there is a heart, there is another heart. You know, cisterna cali or receptaculum cali is called as the lymphatic heart or the second heart of the body. Cisterna cali or receptaculum cali. Right? Lots of things I can share extra. Like when it comes to chapter, I say there are lots of points. Hai. So, you know, because. So, guys, ear is to be done. Now, what you have to do is the ear part is to be done in detail. And the ear ka MCQs and the eye ka thing. So, this will complete the coordination, this particular chapter that will get completed. Okay, and yeah, any question, anything you want to ask? So very nice day, wish you very happy.
Bye bye.
Any other question you want to ask? Any details, anything you want to clear out? So please practice more MCQs, okay? Practice more and more MCQs from this part. So we shall continue the next time. All right, and these notes and all I'll forward to you. Don't worry, we'll forward to you the notes. So we will continue with this ear part in the next lecture. Okay, so thank you so much, guys. Take care. Okay, thank you. Bye bye. See you all. Bye bye, everyone. Bye. No problem. No problem, Devang. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye. Bye, guys. Bye.